But I'm going to start off today by asking just a few questions. Number one is, where is the conviction of God? You see the conviction that you used to see, like, you know, us older people, like you saw back in the day, let's put it like that, back in the day. I wonder sometimes, has conviction even been lost? Has it been lost? Have people just walking on and just thinking that everything is okay and they don't have to be concerned and they don't, you know, you wonder where the conviction is. That's just what I'm saying. Where is the conviction? We're constantly moving. And this world is so fast-paced. That's the way I see it in my spirit, that the world is so fast-paced that we don't have time for anything. We don't stop long enough for anything. You know, we've got to get this done. You've got to get that done. And everything's got to keep going constantly, you know. And I think sometimes that's one of the tricks of the enemy that he has set up, is so that people will not be able to stop long enough to have enough time with the Lord. You know, I've done it myself, you know, and where everything in my life was just like in a tailspin? Is that in a tailspin, where you just could not stop? And then you get to a certain place and you say, oh, you know, you have to stop and take a breath, because you just went and went and gone and gone and done and done and done and done and had so much going on. We've got to stop, people. Even if it's 5 minutes, I'm going to start off with 5 minutes. You get 5 minutes with the Lord, you got to have 5 minutes with the Lord at least. Sure. You know, every day. A lot longer is what we need to make it through this world. But I just wondered where the conviction has gone. And I think when I was thinking about the conviction, I thought about the word complacency. That was the next word that the Lord gave me. He says, some have replaced my conviction with complacency. They just got complacent. Complacent is like self-contentment or self-satisfaction, especially when accomplished by being unaware of actual dangers around you. A feeling of calm satisfaction. That feeling that keeps you from trying harder. That's what Google says. That feeling that keeps you from trying harder. You know. I remember, now I'm not putting the old Pentecostal way on you. I'm just telling you what my experiences was when I was younger. That I felt like as a young Christian, It was pushed on you constantly to do harder, to do more, and to get into the Word more, and to pray more. And, you know, it's good. It was good. It taught me well back then. And sometimes I think that maybe that's what we need to go back to sometimes. Just, you know, not as hard as it was, because there was a lot of rules and regulations back then. You know, and we have been freed, right? We've been freed from those rules and regulations. It's hot in here, Aaron. But years ago, preachers would preach, and they would preach that Satan was lulling or rocking people to sleep. Has anybody ever heard the old-time preachers preach that? Yeah, they would preach that. They talked about people would be get satisfied. They get in a certain position and they just be satisfied. When you get into that position where you get really satisfied, then that's when you say, "Oh, okay, Lord, I don't have time today, but thank you for everything," and walk away. I'm talking about, we need to make sure that we keep our pool that we are in. They said that they would preach that the pool would get stagnated. You know, you got to move, keep that movement going in water to make sure that it stays fresh and clear. You know, you get a lake, Or you get a pond that, that pulls up and stops and has nowhere to go out. You're not putting anything out. Then it, that pool begins to stagnate. That's what I'm talking about. And I see it. I see it in this world. I see it at work when I'm listening to some of the drivers. I see that they are just like in a stagnated place. And I'm praying, God, help us. Help us to be able to go out and tell people. Help us to be able to tell our families and our friends and our neighbors and different ones, you know, whoever the Lord lays on our heart. Somebody in the grocery store, like I've told you time and time again, we're just in the grocery store. Speak to somebody. You know, not, we don't want to be stagnant. We don't want to be in that rocking chair being rocked to sleep. But I can, as I was thinking about this on Friday, I had a whole different way that I was going. All week long, I studied something totally different, and then the Lord changed my mind on Friday, and I saw that it was like the enemy was sitting in a rocking chair, and he was just grabbing people. Just grabbing people. I didn't see any specific anybody, not any of us, but it was like he was sitting there, and he was lulling people to sleep. And that's what reminded me of the old time preachers that would preach this in the old churches where I used to go. There was no movement. They'd be rocked to sleep. There was no movement. They couldn't pray. They didn't pray. They didn't read the Word of God. And the Word of God, we learned last week, is what sanctifies you. You know, the old time Pentecostal was, I'm saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Yeah, Helen remembers that. Saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. How do you get sanctified? Through the Word. We learned that last week. Through the Word of God, the Word of the truth of God is His Word, and His Word is what sanctifies us. Sometimes that rocking chair will cause us to quit church. I've been there. I'm sure every one of us have been there at one time or another. That's not where I want us to get. That's not where I want us to get. Your adversary, the devil, would love to stop you in your tracks. Whatever you're doing good for the Lord, he would love to stop you. But we got an advocate with the Father.
Thank you, Lord.
And he will come and he will take care of things. Everything, sometimes in our life, everything seems to be going good. God forgives us when we mess up. I didn't want to say that. That's in my spirit. God forgives us when we mess up. And he leads us in the right path. He will let us know which way to go. He leads us, just like the Bible says, he leads us into paths that we, because see, we all have different paths. Just like Joey was talking about, some of us are in the winter season. Some of us are in the fall season. Some of us are in the summer or the spring. But I'm telling you, we're all in it together, regardless of what you're going through. I'm supposed to be feeling for you. If you're happy, I'm supposed to be happy with you. If you're sad, I'm supposed to be sad with you. That's what the Bible tells us to do. So we've got to look to those things. And when the Lord says, you know, I will forgive you, he will. He will forgive you. James 4:17, like I said at the end of last week's service, the Lord said, I want this to be your last words to the people. James 4:17, and it says, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. To him that knoweth to do good and then don't do it, it's sin. It's just as plain as that. It's sin, people. Maybe you're in that rocking chair. Maybe you have just give up. I don't know why the Lord is doing this. I don't know who it's for. He did not give me specifics. He just said, this is what I want. And he says, maybe you're in a rocking chair. Before you know it, you're in that rocking chair. And the enemy's got you covered. He's got you where you can't let go. I see somebody like that. Like he won't let go of you. But I'm going to tell you, I won't let go either. Because I know without a doubt that the Lord from you. He will have to flee. So I'm telling you this morning, whoever it might be, or if you're praying for somebody, whoever it might be, my words today is wake up! Wake up! Because it is time to seek the Lord. It is time to look to the Lord. It is time to find the Lord.
Take us in today.
I'll read from the King James Version. It says, "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept, and at midnight there was a cry made, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him.' Then all the virgins arose and they trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, 'Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'Not so, lest there not be enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourself.' And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterwards came also the other virgins, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he answered and said, 'Verily, I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.'" Now, in the Jewish custom, back in the Bible days, the marriage, the bridegroom would come along with some of his close friends. We call them today groomsmen. They would leave his house from where he was at. He had prepared his house before to get it ready for the bride. And so they would go, they would leave, and they would start down the road to the bride's home. He was going to get his bride. That's exactly what Jesus is going to do. He's going to come and get his bride, the church that's ready. And they would do various ceremonies once they got to the bride's house. They do kind of ceremonies. What I think would be like we do bridal showers and showers for the groom, you know, and they have their parties and stuff like that. That's what they were doing, their little ceremonies. So after the ceremonies, then the bride and the groom would walk down the street. They'd walk down the street back to his house where he was going to take his bride. They'd walk through the streets, which was always done after sunset. It was always done in the dark and not at nightfall. When they got finished with all their ceremonies, they got finished with everything that they were doing and the parties and everything, they walked back at night. Now on the road to the groom's home, waiting, would be the bridesmaids, all of her attendants. They would be on the road waiting. They would be looking, just like these 10 virgins were looking. They were waiting, and they fell asleep because the groom had tarried so long. And so, anyway, it says that on the road, there they were waiting. Some of them had prepared for a long wait. Some of them had prepared to tarry. We are, as we would say, we are tarrying for the Lord Jesus Christ. We are waiting for the Lord Jesus Christ. We are constantly, constantly refilling our oil lamps. Constantly, we've got extra oil. We're looking in the Word of God. We're praying. We're doing what we need to do. We're going to church. We're praising the Lord. You know, we're going to do 30 days of praise. We're refilling, in other words. And the Lord fills us up, but we're refilling also by having the Word of God and using the Word of God. So they had 5 of them had their oil lamps and they had their extra oil, and 5 of them had their oil lamps and no extras. And there they were. And when they all woke up, when the cry came that the groom was coming and that the bride was coming and that they needed to get ready and they needed to be ready to go with the bride when the bride came, and the groom, then they didn't have any. They were in the dark. They had no oil. Their oil went out. Their lamps went out. And so they began to ask for the ones that brought extra. See, I'm going to tell you that it don't matter whether grandma or mama or sister or brother or aunt or uncle, whoever, is praying for you. It's good. It's a good thing. Let me rephrase that. Let me not say it's not good. It's a good thing. But I'm going to tell you, you can't ride into heaven. You can't go with the groom when he comes on mama's skirt tail or daddy's skirt tail or aunt's skirt tail or grandma's skirt tail or great-great-great-great-great-grandma's skirt tail. You can't do it. You're going to stand before God for yourself. We're all going to stand before God for ourselves. And we got to remember that. So we got to make sure that our oil lamps are full. That it's us. That I'm the one that's in the Word for me. That I'm the one that's listening to God and hearing what He wants for me to do. What He needs out of me. Filling my oil lamp and keeping my light burning every day of my life. You have got to do that for yourself. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I can see it that I'm talking to like somebody. You kind of see that. It's for you and you alone. You've got to stand before God yourself. Nobody else can stand before God. But here's the bridesmaids, and they're waiting. They had prepared. Five of them had prepared. Five of them had not. Matthew 25:13 tells us, watch therefore. I'm telling you, watch, people. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. We don't know when the Lord's coming. We don't know when God's going to say, okay, my son, go. Go get your children. We don't know. Go get your bride. We don't know when that's going to happen. We've had people say, I know the Lord's going to come back on this day and that day. There's no way that anybody can say that. No way. We can look to the signs. We can read the Bible. We can read Revelation and Jeremiah and Isaiah and all these and see the different things that has happened down through the centuries. And I'm telling you, we can say, yeah, the Lord's coming back. He is coming back. He is coming back, people. We just don't know the exact time. But we know that He's coming. The bridesmaids that had carried enough were ready. They went in. They went in when the bridegroom came. Even though the bridegroom tarried, they still were ready to go in. Some of us, you know, may go with the Lord when we're 5 years old. Some may go when they're 25, 75. And then some may tarry like my mother, 94 years.
Right.
You know, you just never know. But when the Lord calls you, but there'll be a day that He's going to come back for everybody because the Bible tells us that. We start on this journey, we give our hearts to the Lord, we accept Him at His word, whatever He says, we accept Him. You know, you remember the first time when you come to the Lord, when you laid it all down before the Lord. I'm telling you, there's not even words that I can describe to you how light I felt when I finally gave it all to the Lord and said, here it is, God, it's all yours. I'm going to live for you for the rest of my life. I'm going to do the best I can. Did we fail? Yes, we failed at times. But I remember that time. I remember that day. I think I told y'all last week. It was when I was 21. That was the main time that I remember. That was the day. That was the day I got saved. Not when I was young. Not when I was 12, 14, 15, 16. No, 21. 21 in the Kewa Church of God. I remember because I felt that cleanness. I felt that burden just lift off of me, and I knew that it was all taken care of and that the Lord had saved me for sure.
Lord.
For sure. For sure. I'm telling you. But we start out on this journey, and then along the way sometimes we get complacent, like I was talking about a while ago. We get complacent, and it begins to set in and unrest sometimes in our lives. That's when the enemy is trying to drain your oil. That's when he's trying to get your light to go out. And you've got to fight against it. You've got to use the word against, the word of God against it. You know, they have this little thing that says push, you know, pray until something happens. Pray until something happens. And that's what we have to do sometimes. When we feel like the enemy's coming in against us, we got to pray till something happens. This next 30 days, you're going to praise until something happens. That's the difference. That's the only thing. Just praise the Lord for what He's going to do. You know, I was looking at an oil lamp, and I was thinking about how it looked empty. It looked totally empty, Brenda, until you turned it upside down. And then you see that little bit of residue. Today is accepted time, and today is the day of salvation, because the Lord says, yeah, I know you've been praying for this one. I know you've been praying for that one. I know that you've got this one covered, and I know that you've got that one covered in prayer, and now is the day of salvation. It's time to tell them that today is the day of salvation, the accepted time of the Lord. Accepted time of the Lord. God, bring back conviction. God, that's been my prayer since Friday, since the Lord laid this on my heart. God, bring back conviction. Bring back your conviction on people and let them know that you are coming back. And that it's time. It's time. It's high time to wake up out of sleep and begin to tell our families and begin to tell people. You know, I took a chance on my job a couple of weeks ago, and I told you about it because of that one little boy that I was having so much trouble with. And I prayed and prayed and prayed. I've been up in the middle of the night, and different times I wake up with him on my heart, and I just go to my couch and I pray for him. And I say, Lord, I don't know nothing else to do for him in Gwinnett County and anywhere else in Georgia. You're not supposed to say anything about God. You're not supposed to talk about anything. We're not allowed in our buses to speak the name of Jesus to the kids unless they say something. And if they say something, then it's on. It's on for me. But I took a chance. I took a chance because I had to call the parent and I had to talk to the parent. And I told him. And I told him first thing. After we had talked a little while, I told him all the problems and what was going on, and my whole notebook is full of notes about his son. And I told him, I said, I'm fixing to say something, and I may lose my job, because if he had so desired, he would have went to my supervisor and they would have took me off my bus. And I told him, I said, I'm just going to tell you, I've spent many nights praying for your son. Praying for your son. And it got real quiet. And I was thinking, oh, Lord, you know, you got to cover me, God. You got to cover me. And then out of that conversation, I let him know that I was a pastor. And he says, I'm a minister too. And then it changed the whole situation. The whole entire situation changed.
Gosh,
even
good.
The boys changed. Because, you know, I took that chance and I said, listen, you know, I'm just going to tell you, I want you to know, praying for your son. I pray for every one of my children on the bus. Every one of them I pray for. And especially those that I see that I know without a doubt that they're probably going through things. That's what breaks my heart. And if there's ever anything said, and you know, we pray for times where things can be said, where we can open up and say, oh yeah, let me tell you about that. Let me tell you about that. And there are some, they'll say, oh, Miss Baker, this one said a cuss word. We learned in Sunday school not to say it, and you might get to open up and say, oh yeah, let me tell you. See, that's when it was, I know that it's a fine line. There is a fine line. And I am one of those that believe in going by the rules. But there is that fine line where I can speak out at any given moment, because the Lord opens up the word, opens up the times for us. And that's the way that it will be with your family. I see a door opening up. I see a road opening up for somebody to be able to walk through and begin to speak to somebody. I feel that. Somebody here this day is going to walk through a certain door this week. Walk down a certain path. And the Lord is going to expect you to speak His word to that person that's standing there. I see that. I see that, Tiffany. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost.
Holy.
Thank you, Holy Ghost. Move upon them this week, Lord. Give them the courage. Give them the courage to speak your word, Lord. Give us all. Give us all, not just in this church, God, but every church, every person that's sitting under the voice of a pastor this morning, Lord. Every person, God, that is at home seeking your face, Lord. In the name of Jesus, give them the courage, Lord, to speak your word to people, Lord, because the time is short. The time is short. The time is short, people. I would ask you today, again, are you going to be bride ready? Are you going to be bride ready? Are you bride ready now? That means having your bridal garments on, waiting for the bridegroom, even though he's tarrying, even though he hasn't come yet. Even though things look dark, you're not really sure what's going on, but do you have your light shining? That's a good one. Do you have your light shining? Your lamp burning bright? Let's all stand. Our to-do list is to have, number one, is to have our lamps. To have our time with the Lord where we ask the Lord, forgive us of our sins coming to our hearts. The Lord said this morning, I ran and wrote a note. The Lord said this morning, said, prepare them for altar calls. Prepare them for altar calls. We got to do a lesson on altar calls and getting all people ready to work the altars. Because you know, we never know. We never know what's going to happen in this world from moment to moment. We have no clue what's going to happen. But I'm going to tell you, when all the bad things happen, when it gets really bad at times, you're going to find the churches being filled up. You're going to find people looking for the Lord. You're going to find people coming to you on your jobs or calling you on the phone and say, tell me about the Lord. Tell me, how do I get saved? And that's what the Lord is saying. Get them ready for the altars. Get them ready. Get the altar workers ready.